But I'm here today to introduce Julie Marateck. I've actually known Julie for over 10 years. I met Julie when she was working as an intern and a production assistant for a film company called The Journey. I don't know if any of y'all have seen that movie. Since then, she's gone on to bigger and better things. She has led social strategy for Delta Airlines, Razorfish, Ignition, and the beautiful, lovely High Museum of Art. She joined 352 Inc. right down the street recently, and she is a prolific social media superstar, and I think she's going to teach us all how to be the same. I'll be back there taking lots of notes. So with that, let's welcome Julie.
Thanks, guys. I don't usually like sitting in front of a podium. Let me see. Can you guys hear me if I talk like this? Raise your hand if you cannot hear me. You good? Okay, cool. So I'm gonna set my timer here so I stay on track. As Shreem is saying, my name is Julie Marateck, and I'm here to give you guys a talk about how to be a social media superhero. Raise your hand if this is your first time coming to SuperNova South or Digital Atlanta. Wow, big chunk of you guys. Awesome. Well, thank you for spending your Monday morning with me. I spoke at Digital Atlanta about 2 years ago, and that talk was called How to Be a Badass Social Storyteller. So I thought I would switch things up a little bit and talk about how to be a social media superhero. I don't know if you can notice, but I've got my my Marvel bands on today. So I love superheroes, and I love social media, so I thought it would kind of be a fun marriage between the two. I'm super informal. I want this to be more of like a discussion, not as much of me just talking to your faces. If you guys have questions during my talk, feel free to raise your hand. I tend to talk a little fast, so I'm sure that we will have time at the end for Q&A, which I hope we do. So yeah, let's just go ahead and get going. As Shreem was saying, I got my start about 10 years ago. Actually, Journey Productions was a production company that I interned at for about 2 years, and they have disbanded. So there's actually not even a logo online anymore for me to get their logo, but I started off, I loved film production, and then I realized how long it took to actually make a movie, and I was like, ugh, this takes too long, and I don't have the patience for this. So now I've switched things up and gone the social media route, which we all know is really fast. So after I worked at Journey Productions, I worked at the High Museum of Art as their digital marketing person. This was right when social media started to pick up. I was actually working at the High when Obama had his campaign and he joined Facebook, and then I joined Facebook because of that. So I was at the High literally when I joined Facebook. And then I worked at Atlantic Station as their digital marketing strategist, community manager. You guys might not know this, but Atlantic Station has a very dedicated social media team. So when I was working there, I was their community manager, and I actually had to respond to tweets 7 days a week, between 1 and 9 minutes. So they're very on their social media. So I kind of call it my social media boot camp moment. And then I worked at Razorfish, where our client was Delta Airlines. So that was super cool. I got to work for and with Delta to do their social media strategy and their content creation. And then now I'm at 352, which is, as Shreem was saying, is right up the street. It's a product development agency, so they focus on websites and apps and all the things of that digital nature. I encourage you guys to certainly tweet during my talk. The official SuperNova South hashtag is SNS15. And then I'm on Twitter at Julie Marateck, and it's M-A-R-A-T-E-C-K. So I appreciate you guys doing any tweets. All right, so how do you be a social media superhero? Raise your hand if you feel like you are a beginner in social media. Okay, now raise your hand if you feel like you're intermediate or advanced. All right, cool. So my specialty is content creation. So I do a lot of copywriting, imagery, telling stories through social media. And I never really know who's coming to my talk. It's gonna be beginners, intermediate, advanced. So I like to more so just have fun and show examples of companies that I think are doing great job on social media and rocking it out with being a superhero. So these are the six superhero traits that I think any company should have. First one is passion. Like, you should always be passionate about your social media. Be passionate, find a way to be passionate about what you're doing your social media about, because that comes through in your social. Even if it's the most boring thing ever, like working on, you know, maybe an automotive company, find a way to be passionate about it and find interesting things about it so that you feel passionate about what you're presenting to the audience. Another superhero trait is purpose. You want to be purposeful, and you want to find purpose in your social media, and you want your audience to feel like they have a purpose in following you. So why follow a company or a brand? So ask yourself that before you start tweeting and Facebooking. Stay positive. You know, I think that sometimes social media can turn negative. Raise your hand if you think that the upcoming potential dislike button will create positive or negative energy, right? I see a lot of thumbs down, no pun intended. I agree. Like, I think social media should be a positive area. I think that, you know, dislike button, you know, could be an area for negativity to grow. So just find ways to be positive. Another trait is be prepared. So have a backup plan. If things go south, you know, have a way to fix it real quick. Things do, as we know, go south real quickly in social media. You know how things spread like wildfire. So always be prepared. Be personal. So be personal with your audience. And again, find ways to connect with the people that are following you. And be proactive. So just, you know, be proactive, be forward thinking, and be a thought leader. So these are just a couple statistics about social media. The average American spends 37 minutes per day on social media. I actually think it's probably more, but that's what I've been able to find. 46% of users look towards social media when making a purchase. So for any kind of small to medium business companies here, that's huge. Almost half of people look at social media before making a purchase. 3 in 5 small to medium businesses say they've gained new customers by using social media. And 67% of Twitter users are far more likely to buy from brands they follow on Twitter. So if you're not on Twitter, you should be on Twitter. So these are just some fun little icons that I found as far as social media superheroes. So Facebook. Facebook is like a discreet ninja with the ability to travel timelines and dig up information from people's posts. Highs and lows that you thought were lost in the past never are safe from Facebook. LinkedIn. LinkedIn possesses the power of superhuman strength. People trust LinkedIn because of his strength, knowing that he will not let them down. He has quickly become a go-to superhero for when real work needs to get done. Twitter. Twitter uses his super speed to fly around all over the world, relaying information within seconds. News spreads like wildfire with the power of Twitter. Instagram. Instagram, for me personally, is my favorite social media tool. Instagram is like a chameleon with the ability to change colors, shapeshift. Be careful, you can never tell who Instagram really is. Google Plus. I mean, is Google Plus really a superhero anymore? I don't know. That's up for debate. Google Plus possesses the supernatural ability to generate force fields at will. These force fields allow Google Plus to capture and contain content in certain circles, allowing him to keep the bad guys out and the good guys in. And Pinterest. Pinterest is not your conventional hero. She aids those in need of inspiration when they need it most. She's incredibly knowledgeable and artistic, and always seems to have an answer. So I like these because they give, you know, social media a personality, which I always really like. All right, so these, we're gonna start moving into the traits of being a social media superhero and the brands that I think are doing a really great job at being superheroes online. I like to show examples of, you know, brands that are doing a great job and making it happen. So the first trait, I think, of being a social media superhero is that you're superhuman. All right, so what does it mean to be superhuman? I think to be superhuman means to really understand your audience, right? So who is your audience? Why are they following you? So these are a couple examples of some posts that I created when I worked for Delta. And we all know the usual, you know, Throwback Thursday posts. But how do you really know your audience? So one cool thing that I found out when I was working at Delta was there's actually a large group of AV, they're called AV geeks. And that's really like what they call themselves. So they love all things planes and aircrafts. So we started using the hashtag AVGeek in our posts. So I would go down to Delta and take a lot of like behind the scenes imagery of what was going on. And that's a great way to kind of sell without selling, you know, like show what's going on with your brand behind the scenes. People love any kind of behind the scenes imagery that you can show. I also was able to start something called Wing Wednesday. So you know how when people are flying and they take a picture outside their window, everybody does that. So we started with Delta something called Wing Wednesday, and it really took off, no pun intended. And people were using the hashtag, and so every Wednesday it was a great way to get user-generated content going, so that you're not always the one with your brand who is, you know, posting on behalf of your brand. So finding ways to get UGC is really important for knowing your brand. And then of course, Throwback Thursdays. And one really cool thing about working for Delta is they're so historical. So they have all these archives of old, you know, a treasure trove of old imagery and advertisements. So just finding new and interesting ways to tell the story of your brand. So this is recently when Apple came out with the Apple Pencil, and I loved seeing how the brands kind of made fun of that and knowing your audience. So on the left, there's IKEA did a post called Absolutely Familiar, Entirely Free. That's just the IKEA pencil. And then underneath that is introducing Denny's toothpick. And Denny's does a really great job at, they're kind of weird. Like they know their audience because their social media is a little off key, but it works. And so they did one called Your Teeth Performing at Full Potential. And this was great because it was in real time. So as Apple was showing the pencil, you know, their new $100 pencil, these brands kind of jumped in and were like, hey, how about a toothpick or our little free IKEA pencil? I thought it was clever. So this is something that was funny that Groupon did. So it looks a little, you know, it's Monday morning. It's a little, you know, we'll take it as it is. But they did a funny post. It says, we're contractually obligated to let you know every time the banana bunker is featured on our site. I thought that was really funny. So they took one of their kind of weird products and kind of made a joke out of it. So again, knowing your audience and knowing that your audience has a sense of humor, and it actually makes something that looks completely ridiculous, it kind of makes you take notice of it. I mean, how many people, you know, I'm sure if it was just a normal post, I wouldn't even have it in my talk, but because they put a little play on it, made it a little silly, and kind of made fun of it, that's a way to know your audience. Know your audience has a good sense of humor and that they can roll with it. All right, so save the day. So every social media every superhero wants to save the day. And that's really ultimately what we do in social media, is we're saving the day every day by working with people and showing our audience what we do and connecting with people. So as we know, these are like the two, I mean, we all know this post on the left from Oreo, right? It's like the grandfather of viral social media posts. And then on the right, of course, is the Arby's post during the Grammys when they tweeted at Pharrell about his hat looking like the Arby's hat. So these are like, I call them like the unicorns. Like they are the diamonds in the rough. Whenever you have a social media job, I guarantee you, your manager or boss is gonna say like, well, why can't we do a post like Oreo? Or why can't we do one of those like Arby hat posts? And what I wanna say is like, you don't plan it, it just happens. So one thing that I want to make apparent as a social media superhero is you can save the day in a lot of little ways. You know, I think that we all get really caught up in doing the next Oreo post or being the next Arby's Grammy post. And then I think we put a lot of unnecessary pressure on ourselves when we're not creating that next huge viral, you know, social media post that gets shown in the New York Times. And superheroes do that every day. I mean, yeah, they save the world, but they also get the kitten out of the tree, and they hold the girl's hand as she's walking across the street, and they do a lot of little things every day that, you know, also are very super heroic as well. So let's not forget about, you know, the small things that we can do as social media superheroes. Failure. Every superhero fails, and that, I think, is key to knowing who you are and what your brand is. Batman originally was scared of bats, right? He fell in a cave as a kid, got attacked by bats, was freaked out of bats, but then he kind of owned it, and then he became Batman. Peter Parker, kind of a nerd, right? Couldn't get the girl, kind of dorky. I think that's one thing I love about superheroes is they don't start off as superheroes. You know, they start off by messing up and failing and being insecure. So I'm gonna talk for a few minutes about some of the brands that have quote unquote failed on social media and what we can learn from that with our own brand. So on your left is a post that Delta did where they were promoting the World Cup. And instead of, so they promoted the World Cup that the USA won over Ghana. And for showing Ghana, they used a picture of a giraffe, but there are no giraffes in Ghana. So it was like, it became this huge firestorm. I was not working with Delta at this time, but it happened after I took another job. But, you know, it just became this huge deal. And it's, you know, brands freak out when this happens because it's a reflection of your brand. So, you know, I always ask myself, you know, what can we learn from this? So always do your homework. You know, like, it's easy just to assume, oh, it's Africa, so clearly there's a giraffe. But there are no giraffes in Ghana. So I think because social media moves so fast that we need to kind of stop and think about, you know, the detail. On the right, Epicurious did a post right after the Boston bombing where they said, in honor of Boston and New England, may we suggest whole grain cranberry scones. Little tacky, probably, right? But it was a post that they did. And, you know, obviously it created a big firestorm and backfired on their brand. Then they did a follow-up post, which I thought was also bizarre. It said, Boston, our hearts are with you. Okay, that's nice. Here's a bowl of breakfast energy we could all use to start today. All right, so stop inserting your brand into every moment. And that's another thing that I've learned in my jobs, is just as something's happening in the world, it doesn't mean your brand needs to say anything. You know, unless you are like directly associated with that moment, you don't need to insert your brand into the moment, because then, again, you know, people are overly sensitive during these times and take things really personal, and you don't want it to affect your brand. DiGiorno Pizza, their social media manager did not do their homework and did a post, hashtag why I stayed, you had pizza. But the hashtag why I stayed was for domestic violence survivors. So it was people talking about why they stayed in abusive relationships. And they tried to work that into selling pizza. They didn't do their homework. So by all means, to be a superhero, make sure you do your homework. Take 5 seconds to research that hashtag that's trending before you use it. On the right was a post that American Apparel did around the 4th of July. And their social media manager thought those were fireworks, but it was actually the Challenger explosion from 1981. Their social media manager was probably young, didn't even know about the Challenger explosion, thought it was fireworks, and did a post on the 4th of July of the, you know, showing the Challenger explosion. So again, big mistake, but superheroes make mistakes, and we can all learn from those. And this actually happened yesterday. Texas Rangers fire social media member for a Charlie Strong tweet. So what happened was the social media manager that was running the social media channel for the Texas Rangers was putting down a coach on another team and accidentally tweeted it from the Texas Rangers post and not their personal post. So that person got fired. Again, just slow down. You know, like, if you're using Hootsuite, Sprout Social, any of those content management systems, and you have your personal stuff linked up and your work stuff linked up, double check that you're not posting accidentally to the brand and not your personal post. And also, you know, you're representative of your brand. So, you know, I worked for The High, and I knew that if I did posted things personal, even on my personal page, you know, I'm still representative of the high. You know, the women I spoke to work for children's healthcare. Like, they're still a representative of children's healthcare, even when they're not necessarily posting and tweeting on the children's healthcare website. Strength. Superheroes are strong, you know, as we know. The Hulk and Captain America, strong superheroes. So what does it mean to be a strong social media superhero? I look at that as using your weakness as your strength. And a lot of superheroes do that. You know, they use their weaknesses as their strength. And here's some cool examples of some brands that use their weaknesses as strength. One of my favorites is Charmin, right? It's toilet paper. Like, how much fun could you have with toilet paper? You know, imagine getting hired to be the social media person for Charmin toilet paper. You're probably like, great, okay, now what do I do? But they found a really cool way around it, and they've started having fun with their brand, with their toilet paper brand. So one post they did was, come on, dude, replace the roll. What's your biggest potty pet peeve? And then they, I personally like their imagery more than their copy, but, you know, they wrote on the toilet paper roll. Another one that Charmin did was today's forecast, cloudy with 100% chance of softness, daydreaming about toilet paper. Normal, right? So it's conversational. I think they do a really killer job at, like, using their weakness, toilet paper, as their strength. Another brand is Staples, office supplies, super boring. Like, who wants to, you know, be all up on pencils and, you know, paper all day? But this is a video that they did, which I thought was really, really fun, and it was around National Coffee Day.
Coffee? My God. We're out of coffee again.
What?
Stu, we're out of coffee.
We're out of what?
We're out of coffee!
French roast. We got hazelnut. We got Columbia something.
Mm-hmm. All right, it's cute. And again, using your strengthness as a strengthness. I'll use it. I'll create that word. That's a new word. I'm trademarking it right now. Somebody trademark that. Using their strength as using their weakness as a strength for selling, you know, office supplies. And this is a really cool brand. They are an awesome B2B brand, and they are, I think they're German, and they have the most beautiful Instagram photos, and they do these, they're a B2B brand, and so what they do is they ship huge items all across the world for companies, and I can't, their name is in my notes, so if you want me to tell you their name, I'm happy to tell you after this, but it's like a German name. But they may take the most beautiful Instagram photos, and it could be so boring. I mean, it's literally, they just ship things all across the world. But I think it's Maersk, M-A-E-R-S-K, I think is what they're called. But at any rate, they have the most beautiful Instagram feed, and they take the most beautiful photos. So it's really about thinking outside the box, you know, and finding new and innovative ways to tell your brand story. Pop. All right, so pop, what would pop mean as being a social media superhero? For me, it ties into pop culture. So showing, you know, connecting with pop culture with your brand. So this is a brand called Insomnia Cookies, not a big cookie company, you know, not a big brand, but they did a fun post straight out of the oven to kind of coincide with Straight Outta Compton, the movie that just came out. So clever. In the moment, you know, I think what I love about doing pop culture-y posts is that it's relevant and it's timely. You can't do a pop culture post like 10 months down the road. You have to do it in the moment. So they did Straight Out of the Oven. This is a post that we did when I was working at Delta, and it was when Mad Men, the first episode of the final season started. So our designer created this really beautiful image. Kind of the montage to Don Draper, but with a Delta plane in the background. And then the copy I wrote was, "We're mad for the Mad Men season 7 premiere, taking off tonight. Don Draper reminds us to sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride." And hashtag Mad Men, hashtag New York City. I'm a huge Beatles fan, so this was like one of my favorite posts that we did. Delta was a sponsor of the Grammys, and they were doing a tribute to the Beatles. So we did a Beatles post, and we kind of took planes that faces sort of looked like the Beatles faces, and did an homage to the Meet the Beatles cover album. And the content was Ringo Starr and Paul McCartney on stage again. We're so excited to see two of the Beatles that we wanted you to meet our Fab Four. And then it's four of the planes. And of course, this spoke to the people that are following the Grammys and also those AV geeks that we were talking about. And this one is one that Oreo just did. We all love our Oreo social media. Oreo, in association with milk, presents the spilling. And then Oreo horror stories. And it's a little vine that they made kind of to play on The Shining. So their stuff's so clever. REI, so zombies, huge in pop culture now, with all the shows, the movies that are happening, Walking Dead. So they did one called Zombie Survival Gear. And the post has all the different survival gear that you can use if you want to survive a zombie apocalypse. And then it goes into detail even more so after that with like the details of what all the different items are and how they, you know, could save your life during a zombie apocalypse. So really clever, you know, really fun, really clever. I love connecting social media to pop culture moments. Speed. Superheroes are fast. Lightning speed. As I mentioned, when I was working for Atlantic Station, we had to respond. I had to respond to posts between 1 and 9 minutes. So their speed was no joke. I'd be in the shower and I'd hear my Hootsuite go off and I'd be like, oh my God, I need to respond to that. So they took it to the extreme, which was awesome. And Atlantic Station, I give them a lot of credit because North American Properties has really turned their brand around by the use of social media. So it was a constant, I was constantly on social media, constantly responding to what they were doing. And it was a really awesome experience. I learned so much. Like I said, it was social media boot camp. You know, it was like constantly responding to tweets and responding to people. But speed is important. You know, you may not have a rule between 1 and 9 minutes, but, you know, certainly I would say within, you know, as quick as you can get back to people. I think the rule is to try to get back to community management situations between 3 hours, you know, within 3 hours. I usually think like 24 hours is a great time period, but, you know, just be fast. Things move fast. Did anybody go to Tomorrow World or attempt to go to Tomorrow World? I went. Okay, so what really intrigued me about the situation with Tomorrow World, this just happened last weekend, was they weren't expecting rain, and they closed the third day down to people who weren't camping there for the weekend. So they do this post, basically saying, friends, we're really sorry, but we've had to close Tomorrow World down today for people who aren't coming. Well, I believe they had, when I last checked, they had about, I can't remember, it was like 20,000 comments and like several hundred, like hundreds and hundreds of shares. And their social media person was not responding to any of the community management situations, and they were not responding to any of the tweets that were happening. And even if you are, you know, having a fire drill, and I'm sure this was an absolute PR nightmare, and their social media manager probably had no idea what to do because there were so many things happening. I always think it's best to just try to respond to people, and it's okay to not give them any information, but it's okay just to say, you know, we hear you, and please check our website for more information coming soon, right? Because I think what makes people the most angered is when they're not heard. And it's really important to make sure that your audience is heard, even if you're not giving them any information. I'm sure their community manager was like, I don't know what's going on, this is crazy, but it's best even just to respond and say, thank you for your post, we're working on it now. You know, just acknowledge the fact that people are using social to, you know, vent their complaint or talk about what's on their mind. And this is a post for speed, more satisfying than Italian. Snickers did a post when Luis Suarez bit the ear off of another player in the World Cup 2 years ago. So again, very timely. They did it. They got it up. And I thought it was a really fun post in a really non-tacky way to kind of work your brand into a situation. Supersonic. Supersonic hearing. One trait of superheroes is that, you know, they can hear you, they know what's going on at all times, they hear what's happening, they're great listeners. This is a post that my team did for Music City Gives Back, which is a nonprofit or a fundraiser that Carl Black Automotive does every year in Nashville. And so we did a post where basically you could win a meet and greet with Ronnie Atkins, Lee Bryce, and Kit Moore. And so what we did is we had people comment on what country music means to them. So just a super open-ended question. We didn't really put any rules behind it. Just let us know what country music means to you. And we got tons of comments, and people really opened up. Like, people really became personal. One person wrote about her experience with cancer and how, you know, country music helped her get through cancer. Another person wrote about, I think it was her grandma, and somebody else wrote about a relationship ending. I mean, just how country music meant, what country music meant to them. And it was really special. It did really well. We got lots of comments. So it's okay to sometimes, you know, leave things open and just show that your brand is listening. It doesn't need to be anything super fancy or super thought out, but maybe just ask a very basic question and see how it goes. Chick-fil-A, they did a montage of pictures of people celebrating Cow Appreciation Day. Chick-fil-A is obviously, you know, really great brand. They do a lot of great stuff on social. This got 15,300 likes on Instagram. So again, just showing their fans that they were listening to what they were putting out there, that they were showing how important Cow Appreciation Month was, and, you know, showing their fans that they were listening. This is Loci bracelets. Does anyone know what they are? I'm actually wearing one right now. But Loci bracelet, it's just a bracelet that is kind of, I don't know, it's supposed to give you some kind of balance. But what makes it really cool is their social media channel. They have fans post photos of their bracelets off taking them all over the world. And it's, again, it's a really cool Instagram channel to follow because you can see, you know, where their fans are. They take these really beautiful photos of their bracelets and by the beach and the ocean and the rainforest, and we can see here like the mountains and Machu Picchu. So just finding new and innovative ways to show your audience that you're listening to them. And I really feel like the bracelet is, I mean, it's cool, but it's really the energy that's put behind the bracelet on social media and what it represents, you know, travel, freedom, journey, that kind of stuff. And they've really done a great job on their social media channels of showing that. What's Loci? It's L-O-K-A-I, Loci bracelets. Mind reading. Superheroes mind read. They you know, they have x-ray vision and they can, you know, read what's going, you know, read your thoughts. And they're really in the know with what their audience is thinking and doing. Netflix and chill. That's funny, a little gif happening. But so Netflix and chill has kind of become an urban dictionary for you will watch Netflix with your significant other and have it on in the background while you have sex. That's basically what Netflix and chill has become. So look it up in urban dictionary. So you say Netflix and chill. Basically it's like, oh yeah, we'll watch Netflix, but, you know, we're really just gonna, you know, make out. So it's a lot of information for Monday morning, but you guys look like you can handle it. So Netflix made fun of themselves and actually did a post called Netflix and chill? No, really. And then did the little clueless, the clueless gif. So I thought it was really cute, you know, and so it shows that they know what their audience is thinking. They know what people are saying about their brand, and they're kind of coming back at you with a funny and witty, remark. Denny's, as I was saying, Denny's, like, it's a really odd but fun personality on social media. Do something nice today, slip a bacon in your crush's wallet, then they'll go to pay for something and be like, whoa, a bacon. Really weird, but people love it. That got 1,800 retweets. I mean, crazy, right? I think the Denny's brand has been kind of like, I picture the 16-year-old boy who's like just trying to be witty and funny, but it works for their brand, and it shows that they kind of know what their brand is, and they can mind read. They know what their audience wants. Want to convert a booth into a tiny little house like those weirdos on TV who built and buy tiny little houses? But right, it makes us chuckle. It's funny. And then another one, I'm always walking on eggshells around you. Oh, my bad. I'll get a broom and clean that up. And it's like a pan of eggs. So super cute, super fun, you know, kind of that 16-year-old boy humor, but it works. And then another staples one is coffee hack. Use a coffee filter to perk up your smudge screen. So again, they're having fun and connecting with their audience in fun and innovative ways. And sometimes it's just really simple. You know, I think we spend a lot of time crafting each post so perfectly, each tweet, each Facebook post, each Instagram post. As we know, it's unless you are accidentally posting a picture of the Challenger on 4th of July, these posts are and they should be fleeting moments. So I think it's, you know, okay to have fun and, you know, do a post of a coffee filter cleaning your screen. This is something that Old Spice did, which I thought was really, really clever. So they took their Instagram channel and they did a create your own adventure campaign where you would go into Instagram and then they would ask you a question. So you awaken in a dark cave in the distance, you see a faint light in front of you, or in front of you is an open bottle of Old Spice body wash. Go toward the light and then you can pick one of those two options. You can pick that one or you can pick that one. And whichever one you pick takes you on your next, on a new adventure. So it's this whole adventure play. They know their audience, a lot of men. They kind of went the route of like the comic book type thing. I love the imagery that they use for this. So they did this fun like choose your own adventure type play on Instagram. Chipotle. I don't know if any of you played this game. It's awesome. I just went and played it last week. But they did a they've done a Taste Invaders game, which is like Space Invaders, and it's literally like an old school 8-bit game that you can play on your computer. And it says, when space goop attacks, only your burrito torpedo can save the day. Defeat Taste Invaders, save Chipotle. And then they have another one to Throwback Thursday to when lasers went pew pew, play the 8-bit adventure, Taste Invaders. So they've done this whole Taste Invaders thing, and they know their audience. They know their audience likes to, like, they're gamers, they're gamifying their social content. They are young, energetic. They're finding cool ways to insert their brand, and I love these. And so if you do go on Chipotle Taste Invaders, you can actually play a Space Invaders game, but with burritos. It's pretty awesome. I love it. And I think I probably fit into the Chipotle demographic, as you guys do if you guys are interested in superheroes. They had a post, not all superheroes wear capes. And they did this little play with the imagery for like the things they do to create your burrito. Super fun, playful. All right, so every superhero has sidekicks. You can't have Batman without Robin. So who are the social media sidekicks? A lot of times it's the tools that you use and the way in which you present your content. So for instance, these are three content management systems. These are the three that I'm the most familiar with, but as we know, there's tons. There's Edgar, there's Sprout, Shoutlet, there's just tons of different content management systems. But these are the three that I'm most familiar with: Sprout Social, Hootsuite, and Buffer. And they each have their own, they all have pros and they all have cons to them. So I'd be happy to talk to you after this if you have any questions about any of these content management systems. But, you know, use these are your sidekicks. These help you be better, faster, quicker at your job. Also, hashtags. Hashtags are an awesome way to, you know, use that sidekick. You know, I look at hashtags as your sidekick. And here's a bunch of different, I'm going to put this on SlideShare, by the way, in the next couple days. So you don't need to like write down all these tools. But these are some of my favorite hashtag tools that you can use. They all have different things like tag board. You know, if you're having an event and you want to have a screen up and people come to your event and they, you know, want to see all the social media content that people are posting, tag board is great. You know, it integrates it with hashtags that people are using. Social mention, that's one I use a lot to do real-time hashtag search and analysis. So yeah, just a ton. Social mention, write tag, hashtagify me. You know, there's just tons. So hashtags are your sidekick. These are just some best practices as far as using hashtags. You don't want to go overboard on your hashtags. So the research says that 1 to 2 hashtags, especially in Twitter, is key. Anything more than that starts to look spammy. Occasionally with a brand, I'll use 3, but you really want to keep your hashtags to 1 or 2. So like I said, then it starts to look spammy. I think people, you know, look, you have such a short amount of time to capture people's attention when they're on social. So sometimes I think the brain can't comprehend, like, if you have 20 hashtags, what's happening. So it's best to use, you know, less is more when it comes to hashtags on Instagram. Let's see, tweets with hashtags receive 2 times more engagement than those without hashtags. So again, you want to use it, you just don't want to use it too much. Tweets with 1 or 2 hashtags have 21% higher engagement than those with 3 or more. And then tweets that use more than 2 hashtags actually show a 17% drop in engagement. And then tweets with 1 or more hashtags are 55% more likely to be retweeted. So just some cool hashtag statistics for you. Hashtags on Instagram are a different story. Instagram, you want to use more hashtags because that's how you get a lot of engagement on Instagram. I don't think, you know, I don't like it when I go on Instagram and I see someone use like 30 hashtags, like, you know, every like brown chair, folding chair, armrest, people in chair, woman in chair, man in chair. That gets obnoxious. But, you know, pick a few high level hashtags to use when you're doing Instagram and kind of like let that work for you. But on Instagram, you can use more hashtags than you can on Twitter. Reach. Those social media superheroes, we need to reach. We need to reach our audience. You know, the superheroes, they have to reach the people, the community. They've got to reach the world. How do we do that? We put that by doing targeted posts. So Facebook is great for doing targeted posts. And it's really easy, and it's very, you can really integrate it into your social media. You can do specific targeting, or you can do, you can just boost a post. But it's really easy, and nowadays you really have to pay to play. So if you're a brand that is on Facebook, the days of organic reach are dwindling every second. So a lot of times brands are like, why do we only have 2 likes, or why do we only have 1 share? And the answer is because, well, you're not putting paid behind it. You really have to put paid behind your Facebook posts now as a company if you want it to reach an audience. We've seen a significant increase at my current job with our current client putting between paid and non-paid posts. And again, it can be, it's Facebook makes it really easy, of course, so they want your money, but they do make it very easy to put paid behind posts. Facebook is pushing brands to pay for reach, as I just said. You know, it's really pay to play. This was in February of 2014. You know, you can really see the decrease in organic versus putting paid. You know, if you're a Coca-Cola or you're a Delta, you know, we could put up a post and with organic reach and maybe get 2,000 likes. And then if we put paid behind it, it would be like 20,000 likes. So it's just crazy how much putting paid behind social media makes such a big difference. And you don't need to put a lot behind your posts. So, you know, even just $10 behind a post, you know, I mean, if you're a startup, a nonprofit, I mean, you know, if you're not the Deltas and the Coca-Colas, that's okay. Like, you don't need to put hundreds and thousands of dollars behind posts. You know, even $10, $15, $20 behind posts make a huge, huge difference between people seeing your content and not seeing your content. So, you know, just keep that in mind. You don't have to put, you know, $500 behind a post, you know, $15 behind a post. And, you know, think about which post is most important. If you're having a big event coming up, you may want to put, you know, put $15, $20 behind that. And you'll see a difference. Same thing with Instagram or with Twitter. You can also put posts behind tweets and make them promoted posts. Same thing. You can, you know, just put some money behind them and they'll show up in the Twitter feed, which we all know. I mean, we're all savvy enough to see the promoted posts, but you know, you see them, but are you really using them? I think that's the question. All right, so this part is, I'm gonna talk for a minute about the villains of social media. So you can't be a superhero without your villains. So these are some of the villains that I think affect our social media. First one is things going viral. As we know, people saying, why isn't it going viral? Or why aren't you the next Oreo? Or aren't we doing the Arby's post? I think that's kind of a villain because it kind of gets you in the way, sets you up sometimes for failure because you or your brand, you know, it's one in a million that you'll come up with the Arby's post. And by all means, try, but it's okay that you're not. Time. You know, we know social media moves fast. It's active, it's busy, it's, you know, you're in it every day, all day. Social media never sleeps. So how do you do it without getting burned out? Trust. You know, a lot of times at companies, when I was working at Razorfish, you know, you had to go through several approvals to get one Facebook or Twitter post up. And sometimes it's because companies hear about those situations with the community managers, you know, who post something to their, you know, their wrong post and everything goes, you know, goes downhill. But trust, I think, is an important factor. So building trust with your employees and your company and not being that micromanager that has to read and approve every single Facebook post and every single tweet. You know, usually that happens a lot more with bigger brands, and you know, I understand why, but it's important to build build trust so that trust isn't a villain. Scope. So what's interesting is at my previous jobs, we would do scope based on type of work that we're going to do and not time. So, you know, we would promise Delta that we would do, you know, 30 Facebook posts a month, 50 tweets, 30 Instagram posts. But what happens is sometimes those don't work for you. And you'll start seeing like, oh shoot, well, maybe we shouldn't have committed to doing 30 posts or, you know, 50 tweets because it's not making a difference. So what's cool is that my current job at 352, they don't do scopes. So there's no scope creep. What they do is they bill, and their scope is based on time. So we don't ever promise our clients that we'll do, you know, 100 Facebook posts and 200 tweets a month. What we do is we say, you'll get this many hours from us, but it's up to us to decide what's going to work best for your brand. And, it, you know, it's okay to push back like that. You know, I think a lot of companies want to know exactly how many posts you're going to do, but that doesn't always work best, especially in social media when things are changing month by month, really day by day. Selling. Not being overly salesy. You know, I think a lot of companies are just selling on their social media, but, you know, it's kind of the idea of selling without selling, which is something that I think a lot of the brands that I'm pointing out to you today are doing really well. Like Chipotle's not just posting about a, you know, $3 burrito. They're making you play a game. They're gamifying you, but they're still, you know, you're still in the brand and you're still doing what the brand wants. You're paying attention to them and you'll probably go into Chipotle and, you know, buy your burrito. And this one, I just wanted to open up to you guys. What other social media villains do you think are out there? What else would you say is the biggest challenge is social media? Yep.
Early on, I used to post the same thing across all the time.
Uh-huh.
And I figured out very quickly what I was doing. Even though it's really convenient.
Yeah.
So I tweaked because they're all different time.
Absolutely.
So I would certainly see that as a villain of being able to get the reach.
What made you, do you think the challenge was just time? Like it just takes more time to have to post different content to different channels?
Well, it does take extra time, and also you have to have, I think, a decent understanding of who your audience is on each platform, and or what demographics of each platform are. LinkedIn is completely different from Facebook.
Right.
And, you know, Twitter, for example, like the other two, there are similarities, and there are certain posts that I might tweet a little better with the same incentive. Post up with the same attachment, or change the wording, but
yeah,
with the same attachment. Yeah, I play with that, and I, yes, it takes more time, and you have to be on top of it. It's not just clipping something or planning something for a future post.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, it bothers me when I go on a brand. Yeah, no, absolutely. It bothers me when I go on a brand page and their tweets are just direct posts from Facebook. They don't even change the wording. They just say, like, you know, it just has, it's like just directly from their Facebook channel. Yeah.
Well, I think another one is just assuming that, you know, oh, I'll just get a Facebook page for my business, or, you know, because it's easy. But it's not. I mean, like, everything you've been talking about, there's so much thought that has to go into every aspect of content planning and all these various mm-hmm. things. Just assuming that, like, anyone can do it and it's really, really easy. You're going to put up a post and a million people are going to like it.
Right.
So involved. And also to sort of piggyback on what you were saying, also that assumption that you need to be on every platform. Mm-hmm. Some of them don't make sense. So
no, absolutely. Business,
Facebook may not make any sense at all, but they may need to focus on LinkedIn and Twitter to really meet whatever.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. I think it's better to, I think, again, less is more. I would rather see a brand do one channel and kick ass than do four and just be kind of mediocre. So it's okay to not be on every channel. Yeah, there's definitely a false sense of like, oh, we have a Facebook page, so why don't we have 10,000 followers? And they don't understand, you know, you've got to create your new content, user-generated content, and the biggest one of all, put paid.
Yes. As a user, I always remember error.
Oh, yeah. That's a good one. Yeah, take a second to read your stuff before it goes out. I mean, we all know that, you know, again, superheroes are also human, and humans make mistakes. But, you know, really try. I think it reflects really poorly on a brand. I think we were looking at, like, Sam Smith, the artist's Instagram channel recently. And he, I don't know if he's doing his Instagram or someone else is doing it, but they misspelled the word there. It's T-H-E-R-E, but, like, three times. And then you're just like, oh, come on, man. Like, I really like your music, but spell correctly.
I'm tired of that. It's not a
brand. Yeah.
Sometimes
yeah.
you get... Sometimes the there and there might not be because you don't understand it.
Yeah.
It is,
I agree.
Right? Or, but it might, you know, maybe we're closer to there.
Right. Right.
And so plug it in.
And I'm super... I get it. And I'm super OCD. Like, if I notice anything in my post after I post it, I'll go and edit it. Because on Instagram, actually, now you can edit your post, which is awesome. So if you are on the fly and, you know, you forgot to spell something, you know, just go in there and you know, fix it real quick. You don't have to always delete it and redo it. I will say, one thing I learned the hard way is if you do put paid behind Facebook posts, after you put, once it starts running, you can't edit it. So you can't, you know, they do that so that you can't start changing the words to try to get, you know, more bang for your buck. But so especially if you're putting paid behind a Facebook post, double, triple check that everything is perfect in that post, because once it goes out there and there's paid behind it, you can't re-edit it. You have to delete it and redo it. Yeah.
I was going to say there in the early animation, I think you were talking about Facebook and how they're considering a pay to play model. You kind of have to know how these like social platforms can change it, because after that,
yeah.
Lots of different platforms that are bad.
Absolutely. Just keeping up with, you know, what's going on, keeping up with the social Joneses. All right, I'm gonna keep moving forward. We got 6 minutes, and I'm almost done. And I will say that, you know, if you do have questions, if you do need to leave right at 10, I completely understand. If you do want to stick around and do some Q&A, then we can certainly do that. But just some awesome apps. These are some apps that I love. Snapseed is great. It's awesome for taking photos, and outside of kind of the normal Instagram type filter. Another one is Instagram Layout. It is great. You know, now Instagram has their own. Version where you can do collages. This is Instagram Hyperlapse. This is actually a hyperlapse I took while riding a bike in Amsterdam. It was kind of frightening, but again, I love Instagram Hyperlapse a lot. You know, y'all, it was so crazy, like getting my start in film, and to do some kind of time lapse was such an ordeal. Now you can just open up your little hyperlapse app and go with it. What? Oh, Hyperlapse. Hyperlapse, and it's owned by Instagram. Instaplace is a really fun way to tell. I always like to find new and innovative ways to tell a story of your brand. So it's called Instaplace, and they can use their geofencing, find out exactly where you are, and then put copy on your image. And it's just a fun way to, like, you know, talk about, you know, if you're having a Halloween party for, you know, children's healthcare or something, you know, do InstaPlace and do like Happy Halloween on there in the picture. Periscope. How many of you guys are using Periscope? Okay, cool. Periscope's really cool. I try to incorporate a little bit into the brands that I work with, but it's basically live broadcasting. It's really fun, and you can do live broadcasts from wherever you are, whatever you're doing, and they only stay up for a very short amount of time. So it's very in the moment driven. This is called Go Animate, and this is a fun, I was gonna show you the video, but we only have four more minutes. But it basically, I'll show you a second of it, but it's not an app. You can do it on your desktop, but I learned it really quickly, and you can basically create an animated video to tell your brand story. And I'll just show you guys like a few seconds of it.
We're racing to Planet Hackathon for an insider's look at a new product. Meet QA analyst Annie and back-end developer Dave. Oh, and say hi to DevOps Dennis. It's way too risky to run tests on a live server. So Annie and Dave ask Dennis if he can help them copy one. Dennis spins into a spiral of server anxiety. Cloning servers takes him over 30 steps and at least 30 minutes to complete. And here's Clonebot, who arrives just in time to put the easy in EC2 cloning. Say hello to Cloner. With the push of a button, Cloner duplicates and destroys servers in a snap. It's so simple, even a robot can do it. The dashboard...
Okay, so basically you get the point. You can make these animated videos that maybe tell a product, the story of a product, or even your own company or an event. They have a subscription service, but it's really cool and it's really easy to use, and it's called Go Animate. I wasn't planning on really going through this because I don't like copies with a lot of, I don't like slides with a lot of copy on it, but again, I'll put this up on SlideShare, but I did just a few slides with some best practices, so you guys can look at this when I get it up on SlideShare. This is best practices for tone and voice. Twitter best practices, Facebook best practices, and putting paid behind social. And that concludes how to be a social media superhero. Thank you. Perfect, 2 minutes. So if anyone has to leave, but I'd be happy to do any Q&A with you guys if anyone has any questions.
Yes.
I heard, you know, after famous Oreo post, I heard that the Oreo brand uses a team of people, and they basically do like a 24-hour or not maybe 18-hour in a couple of shifts, and they have several people, a couple of people from their agency and somebody from the company, just monitoring stuff and coming up with things.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, usually big agencies like that, because actually the agency that did that post is in Atlanta, and and so is the guy that did the Arby's hat for Grammys. He's in Atlanta too. So go ATL. But yeah, they usually have a team of people who get together, and especially during a live event like the Super Bowl. When I was at Razorfish, and we were working with Delta, so like for the Grammys, the social media team from Delta and then the social media team from Razorfish would get together and usually watch the live event and then come up with posts on the fly. So yeah, I'm sure that, I don't know if they did like 18 hour shifts, but probably, they're Oreo.
Yes?
So it may have been the last couple slides, but can you talk a little bit about, learning the best time of day, how do we kind of find what's best for your audience?
Well, a lot of that has to do with your brand. And there's a great tool called, I just forget the name of it. Aaron, what's the name? What's the name of the tool we use to look up Carl Black competitors? Okay. All right, yeah, okay. So there's a great tool that you can look up and you can find who your competitors are and what day and time they're posting. I think we did it for also Gainesville Health and Fitness. And so there's not one overall answer. I would say Sundays are usually quieter, and the start of the week starts to pick up. You know, there's truth in, like, you know, weekends can sometimes be a little slower, but it depends on your brand. If you're a brand that's really busy on the weekend, you're the Falcons or the Atlanta Braves, then you want to be pushing that out. So we will have that tool for you in a minute. Rival IQ. Yes, so thank you. Thanks to my my assistant. Yeah, Rival IQ is a great platform to use to look up your competitors' information, finding out when you should be in the mix too.
Yes. When you have a company that's main product is sold as a business to business company, do you really think that these different platforms work? Because they seem to mostly be geared towards the end.
The B2C, yeah. No, that's a really great question. You know, most of my experience is with B2C, and actually my job now is the first time I've been a little bit more B2B. I think it all depends on, and other people can jump in on this too, I think it again depends on the brand. I think it's important to be use social for B2B with Twitter, and I think LinkedIn is great. You know, I think I didn't talk a lot about LinkedIn today, but if we are trying to do, you know, let's say we launch like that cloner, the little video I showed you guys, and we're gearing that product toward scrum masters, project managers, those types of people. Well, where are you going to find those types of people? Probably on LinkedIn. So I would say for the B2B, Twitter is great for engaging with those other B2B brands and creating conversations with them. And LinkedIn is really wonderful too for B2B. Facebook, you know, I don't think Facebook is great for B2B. Instagram, potentially, if you just, you know, want to show the personality behind your brand.
Can I actually weigh in on that? I'm going to speak a little bit about that tomorrow in my session at 10:30, I think. Yeah. I think I'll be 10:30. And we actually do think that Facebook is good for B2B in addition to their social channels. The people you're talking to are actually people at companies, because 71% of everybody's on social media is on Facebook. So if you're actually talking to people and you know the people and you're not trying to reach their brain, we do get to go there.
No, you're fine.
In addition to Twitter and LinkedIn, depending on what kind of people it is, I'm going to touch on it.
It's a good plug for Shireen's talk. No, actually, one thing why I love. That's actually one thing I love about social. There's really no right answer, right? I mean, you can never say you're a social media expert because it's been around for like 2 days. I mean, it's like, you know, and everyone has different perspectives. So yeah, it may be, Facebook may be great, like I said, if you're trying to reach the people, but not necessarily the brand. But yeah, definitely go the way of LinkedIn and Twitter if you're doing B2B. Any other questions? I think we are exactly at 10:03, I just really want to genuinely thank everybody for coming today. This kickoff to Monday morning, kickoff to SuperNova South, spending your morning with me. I hope that you got, you know, if you got one nugget of information out of our hour together, then to me that's a win. I really appreciate you coming, and it means a lot to me. I have some superhero buttons up here. I made these little like Captain America shield with a hashtag in the middle. So if you want a button, please come up and get one. I have my business cards. Everybody should want to come up and meet me. So thank you so much for coming. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Julie. What a great way to kick off this year's SuperNova South. I wanted to let you guys know that at 10:30 in this room, we are going to have a session on video marketing for social. And after that, we're going to have our lunch keynote. And our lunch keynote today is Andrea Arena. She is a woman who is hilarious, I must say. She's hysterical. She's inspirational. She took $5,000 and built it into a multi-million dollar company and then sold it for $1 gazillion. She's a baller, as she likes to say. So she'll be in here at 11:45, 12 o'clock, and we'll have box lunches, I believe, for purchase. So this is a good hot happening room, but we also have sessions going on about 5 at a time, which you can check out on your SCED app. And thanks again for showing up and for being such a great audience for Julie. We'll be back in here at 10:30 for the next session. Thanks.
Yes.